Hey guys, welcome back to Golang Tutorials. This is Jalo DSM, your host. So, in this episode, we're gonna look through some of the features of struts and interfaces in Go. So basically, we're gonna go through the basics of struts in Go, about the initializing a struct, and what about the receiver function, and about the embedding types. And finally, we will go through the interfaces. So, let's begin with the initialization of struts in Go. So basically, what is a structure? I mean, if you are familiar with the basics of OOPs, object-oriented programming, in any other language, you know, basically you have some features to a physical entity, you have some physical entity and you have a program model of that, and you have some features of that, and you want to wrap up everything, like its functionalities, its features, everything into the model. So you wrap everything into an object model. That's the basic concept of object-oriented programming. So Go is an object-oriented programming language, but there are some critics that Go doesn't provide classes and stuff like that, but actually Go has done it in a very intelligent way. So Go has basically interfaces and struts. So through structures you can implement the features, like you can say give some features to an object, and through the interfaces you can give the functionality to them. Okay, let's start the coding. So let's define it. Okay, we are here. Okay, fine. Package main. Basically, we'll save this one. Struts. Go. Okay, so we start the main function here. Okay, before the main function, we'll go through it. We'll make a simple structure, and this structure is a circle. So the basic keyword is type, and we will type the name of the structure that we want. I want to keep this in lowercase because I'm not going to export this. So anything that we export in Go need to be in the uppercase. Starting letter should be in the uppercase, but we are not exporting, like we are not making it available for any other module, so we can keep it as in lowercase letter. So it's in a struct, and we can give the basic in the structure. We can give any other types, like I'm gonna go with the primitive types, like I want to give a x, which is basically a float value, and I am gonna go with a y, which is also a float value, and at the end there is a radius, which is a float value itself. So this is a way we can define this, but there is another way. If you guys have gone through the previous tutorials, you might know that we can define it like this also, comma radius. This is also fine here, and we can initialize. This is the basic definition of the circle, which is a struct, and we can initialize like this as x. Okay, x might be confusing. We can see give it a c equal to new, using new keyword, where it provides some memory for the circle, the new c variable. Okay, we can give c dot x equal to something like 10.10. okay, and we can just print it like this, empty dot print line. We'll print c. okay, then we'll see what it looks like. So we'll run this. Go run, it starts to go. So it printed the 10 and 0 and 0. This is the, it basically we initialized only the 10 value, but it also printed the 0 and 0 other values. It will initialize, since we used the primitive x and y, like the float one, so we'll get the initial value as 0. So there is another way we can initialize this, like this circle, and we will provide something like the circle as x. You can give x as some, again, 10.0. this is also a way we can initialize the structure. Okay, again I expect to get the same answer, so we got the same answer, but this time you might notice, you notice an and symbol, where there isn't an and here. So what is that? When we use the new keyword, basically we are giving a pointer. Okay, So we are creating a memory space for that. So there we actually we got the pointer of the circle structure like that we create in memory. Here we are simply creating memory. Okay. So there is this is a one way. Oh, and this is the way we can initialize structures in Go. Next we're gonna go through the receiver functions. So what is the receiver function? Basically in Go there is only structure, there is no class. But if you are familiar with class in using while using C++ or Java, you know, you want to do something with the circle, like this for a circle you want to show its area. So there should be functions for that. So we can do that with a simple receiver function. Okay, I will show a simple receiver function. Look at, and we will receive here as C and circle and something like area. Okay, basically we gonna return a float 64 value itself and return 3.14. I'm just putting as 3.14 star R star R. Okay, we are good here. So now we'll give it a try. Print line C dot, you can see something pop ups here like area. So we give area. So what it does basically is that we pass an argument, like an argument, we pass the circle here. And we, okay, I forgot one thing, it shows an error here, isn't it? The error is undefined R. Okay, C dot R, basically I forgot, my bad. Okay, C dot R, basically it will multiply this 3.14 with the R value, like the radius that we have given to the C. So we should return the area of the circle that we have passed here, and it will print it. So let's check it, whether it want to print it or not. Okay, this time it's 0 because we have passed the radius as 0. We'll put it as R here, and I can check it out. This time is 314, that's correct, I guess. So basically we can pass, like our structures can have the functionality of a class where they can have functions implementing, manipulating their data. That's basically through this receiver functions. Okay, you know why we use receiver function, that is that particular name, because these are like methods. So what is the difference between method and function? And function is basically, in function if we give some arguments like x, and whenever we give the arguments x as some particular value as 10 or 20, it will always give the same result. But it need not be the same case with the methods. Like if we give here, I'm giving a float value like o float value, and I am multiplying it with something like o. Okay, and here we are giving some value 3.0. okay, so basically now it give 942 value, and now I am here changing it as 20. So in this case we are passing again 3.0 as a parameter, but this time since it is a method, it is a receiver function, it should give different answers, isn't it? So yes, so methods do depend upon the state on which they are applied, while function does not they do not depend on the state. Okay, because they are stateless, methods are state based. Okay, that's a simple point that I just want to share. So another feature of struts is that you want to embed, like you want to inherit a property of a structure. Like that happens with a object-oriented program, the basic idea is you want to inherit the properties of a particular class to another one, like a particular object to another. So we have this functionality in Go, it is in different way. Okay, we will use something like this, like we have type. I'll say one-sided circle. Okay, one-sided circle, it doesn't happen, it's a hypothetical circle. Okay, so it's a structure. So what it does have is it has a circle, also it does have one side, I may say it is, since it is in a hypothetical circle, length of the side is len, which is in float 64.
Okay,
so let me say you restricted keyword length. Okay, that's fine. So what we do is we use a one side circle. We say it as a one side circle. Okay, we don't use this thing. We say it as one side circle. And look at this. We could use the area function of the one side circle. Basically, in this case, it should give a zero. Okay. We can access the variables like x, y, z used in this manner. C dot. You can see a circle popping out here. C dot circle dot r equal to 3.0. Okay. Now we're gonna try this. We got 84.7. Like I don't want to do the math, but I think that's correct. Okay. So what it does is that we can use the functions that is passed by its parent, like the class, like the structure that we inherited. So we can use this function, its receiver function, in this manner. So basically what we are doing is we are embedding a structure into another. So embedding a type into another type. So this is the basic way of inheriting structures, and we use this for functions like this. Okay. So this is the basics of the structures in Go. Now we are going to go to interfaces. So before going to interface, we need to know why we want to use interfaces. Okay, so let's take a basic example where I have an employee working under manager in India, and the same company has another manager who is working in Japan, and he to have an employee, like he to have a guy working there. So at some point of time, the Japanese manager and Indian manager has to exchange their workers, like their employees. So the Indian guy went to Japan, and the Japanese guy came to India. So there is one problem here. Both of these employees do like coffee very much. So they have to, the manager asks, do you want anything? So they have to answer, yes, I want some coffee. But problem is, the Indian speaks Hindi and the Japanese speaks Japanese. So both the managers don't, Japanese manager don't understand Hindi, and the Indian manager doesn't understand Japanese. So how can we do it? We should have some common interface. Okay, we'll see that. Okay, what we want to do is we just remove these things. Okay, we'll say in this cases we use the interface, where interface says these structures should implement a particular function to be an interface. Okay, to be an object of, like to be an interface, it should implement this function. If this structures do implement these functions, then we'll be talking through these functions. Like Japanese manager and Indian manager comes to a conclusion that if the employee raises his hands, then that means he want a coffee. That's it. That's the only thing. So even it doesn't matter the way the Indian employee or Japanese employee understand they want coffee. They just make sure, they just raise their hand. Okay, that's it, they got the coffee. The manager understand they want a coffee, that's the way it's done. So here we are going to do an example. So we'll take the Indian guy, we'll say type Indian and struct he speaks the integer language. Okay, here I change Hindi to integer language, and type Japanese, it's here, okay, fine, Japanese, and struct he speaks string language. Okay, doesn't matter, we are in the programming world, so we use this kind of language here. So what we do is that there is an interface, like the manager asks the employee. Okay, so interface which should implement a method name called what manager asks. Okay, we'll put it as something like employee should implement this method, where the function is employee ask and should get an answering string. Okay, so what here happens is the Indian guy, give a function for, and we give a receiver function for an Indian guy. So I Indian and manager asks and Indian guy replies. Something like this. Dot. So we are converting the integer to an. So I dot. Excuse me. I'm sorry, there was some noise going on here, that's why. So the Japanese guy, says manager asks, and he also gives the string where he use returns. Where the returns did come? Okay. Returns the J dot speaks. So I think we can now both of this Indian and Japanese has an interface here. Now we can call these functions. Okay. Manager asks. So in the remote location where we use function remote location accepts a parameter employee and it just says fmt dot print line employee dot manager asks. So that's nothing much here. What we want to do is we say I equal to Indian and Indian speaks two. Basically he says he wants two coffee. Okay, that's much. We need to really drink much coffee. And there's a Japanese guy who speaks same. I guess they can also drink two coffee. There's no issue in that. So in the remote location, what we want to do is remote location of Indian, and in the remote location location, okay, my bad, I just went back. So when the Japanese and Indian guy go into different locations, remote location, how does it pay off? Okay, let's try. Okay, manager asks, not enough arguments to call. Okay, what did I miss? Nothing arguments in code to make method expression employee dot manager ask. Okay, my bad. I really said E. Okay, I really forgot that. Okay. So what does one says two? They want two coffee in different level. So this is the way the interface works in Go. And you know, when you go rounding off with a lot of problems, lot of programs in Go, the most things that you want to use interfaces and structure, you want to be playing a lot with this interface and structures in Go. So that's it. So if you guys have any queries, just comment below in the video. So that's it. Thanks guys. Love and peace.